First, I'd like to thank the music theory department at Eastman, and of course, John Kovach and the University of Rochester Institute for Popular Music for extending me the invitation and jointly sponsoring today's lecture. It's always a pleasure to return to the Eastman School, and I'm happy to see so many eager, young, and up-and-coming music scholars, as well as some familiar and distinguished faces in the audience. You should all have a copy of the detailed 16-page handout on which you can take notes or simply keep as a souvenir. If everything goes according to plan, we will also be projecting the musical examples on the large screen for the benefit of those who are watching this talk remotely. Before I begin, I want to offer a few words of explanation about the long gestation period leading up to today's talk. Some of you may remember a paper I presented at the annual meeting of the Society for Music Theory in Montreal in 2009 called Absent Tonics in Pop and Rock Songs. I did not quickly turn that paper into a publication, a good move in hindsight, yet it has since been cited several times, and in the ensuing years, several other pop music theorists, most notably Walter Everett, Philip Tagg, Christopher Dahl, David Temperley, and Trevor de Klerk, both together and separately, Nicole Biamonte, Brad Osborne, Brett Clement, and my own former CUNY doctoral student, Drew Nobile, have weighed in with their own ideas on the question of tonality in pop and rock music. Despite this explosion of new scholarship, a comprehensive theory of how tonality in pop and rock music works has yet to be agreed upon by music theorists. And indeed, based on my own conversations with certain senior scholars in the field, there are some who question whether or not rock music even is tonal music, at least in the conventional sense. Since my original talk in 2009, I have been gathering many more examples to bolster my case and have refined my theoretical ideas considerably, drawing upon the ideas of these other scholars where appropriate. More recently, I gave an expanded version of the paper in 2014 at the University of Cincinnati, and it has since grown even more. I believe the paper is now just about ready for prime time, and in light of the intensity of this ongoing debate, I'm framing it now under the larger umbrella of the question of tonality in pop and rock songs. So I'd like to start by anticipating my conclusions, positing three tonal scenarios that I'll be exploring further over the course of today's talk. One, songs with a fragile tonic, in which the tonic chord is present, but its hierarchical status is weakened, either by relegating the tonic to a more unstable chord in first or second inversion, or by positioning the tonic mid-phrase rather than at structural points of departure or arrival. Two, songs with an emergent tonic, in which the tonic chord is initially absent, yet deliberately saved for a triumphant arrival later in the song, usually at the onset of the chorus. And three, songs with an absent tonic, an extreme case in which the promised tonic chord never actually materializes. In each of these scenarios, the composer's toying with tonality and its expectations may be interpreted as a means of enriching the song's overall message. I will offer close analyses of songs with fragile, emergent, and absent tonics, drawing representative examples from a wide range of styles and genres across the past 50 years of popular music, including 1960s Motown, 1970s Soul, 1980s synth pop, 1990s alternative rock, and recent US and UK number one hits. Example one provides a formal synopsis of Daryl Hall and John Oates' 1973 song, She's Gone, alongside a summary of the harmonic content in each of the song's respective sections. Like many pop and rock songs, She's Gone opens with an extended introduction built upon an oscillating two-chord vamp. In this case, close position A major and B major triads alternating over a B pedal. Well over a minute into the track, the vocals enter with the first verse, the initial three lines of which are built upon this same oscillating vamp, yielding fleetingly to G-sharp and C-sharp minor seventh chords in the fourth line, before returning to the vamp for the song's second verse.
Everybody's high on consolation. Everybody's trying to tell me what is right for me. My daddy tried to bomb me with a sermon, but it's plain to see that they can't comfort me. I'm sorry, Charlie, for the imposition.
How are we to make sense of the tonal information that has been presented to us so far? All of the chords conform to a key signature of four sharps, suggesting E major, and yet the tonic chord is notably absent from the verse's chord progression. In fact, the entire introduction and first two verses seem to be all about prolonging the dominant, with particular emphasis placed on the A major over B slash chord, what I have christened the sole dominant, that begins and ends each verse. This distinctive keyboard sonority, which here is best thought of as a close position 4 chord over scale degree 5 in the bass, hence conflating subdominant and dominant functions, is common to many pop and rock styles, but is particularly prevalent within the lush extended harmonic language of 1970s soul music, hence its nickname. The resulting effect felt throughout the introduction and first two verses of She's Gone is one of constant tension, setting the stage for the E major tonic chord to emerge triumphantly in the song's chorus. When the tonic chord ultimately does emerge, however, it is quite fragile, relegated to a passing harmony in first inversion.
She's gone.
She's gone.
Oh, I. Oh, I.
I better learn how to face.
She's gone.
She's gone. Oh, I.
Oh, I.
I pay the devil to replace her.
She's gone.
And she's gone.
Oh, I.
What went wrong?
The ending of She's Gone is also special and merits further commentary. Rather than fading out in E major, instead, the third chorus gives way to a short but remarkable instrumental break, fully loaded with horns, strings, and a wailing lead guitar, that once again shines a spotlight on the sole dominant and consists of no less than 3 consecutive truck driver's modulations up by half step. Out of all this, the final chorus re-emerges a third higher in the chromatic mediant-related key of G major, above which Daryl Hall's voice soars with passion and anguish as he hammers home the song's title lyric and bemoans the loss of his lover for one last round. With nowhere else left to go, the chorus simply repeats and fades away.
She's gone. Oh, what went wrong?
Gotta love Daryl Hall. As Walter Everett has recently confirmed in his book, The Foundations of Rock, non-tonic openings, such as we encounter in She's Gone, have been quite prevalent in pop and rock music since at least the 1960s. Surveying a variety of such songs by the Beatles and others, Everett aptly notes that, quote, "These songs all find their tonics eventually with a rush of familiarity that often seems like the dissipation of clouds." a phenomenon that I call an emergent tonic. Yet sometimes this oral game of hunt the tonic is not quite so simple, a case in point being the Four Tops 1966 number one Motown single, Reach Out, I'll Be There, example two. The 8-bar introduction to Reach Out, which features the song's signature exotic-sounding flute riff, clearly establishes E-flat minor with its chords alternating between 1 and 5 every other bar. This sense of E-flat minor as tonic is immediately thwarted at the onset of the verse, however, as the chord progression is taken over suddenly by an oscillating vamp of A-flat minor 7th to D-flat major chords that repeats 5 times. Essentially, these two chords get locked into a seemingly ever-repeating loop. As I've shown in my harmonic analysis below the staff, this two-chord vamp may be interpreted as a repeating 2-7 to 5 progression, searching for its tonic in the relative major key of G-flat, a goal that is made clear only at the onset of the pre-chorus, when we are presented with the title lyric for the first time. Almost as soon as G-flat major has been established, the sense of tonic is thwarted yet again, as first inversion and root position G-flat chords yield to a first inversion B-flat major chord, these three chords being anchored by James Jamerson's bass line in falling major thirds, followed by a fully diminished leading tone seventh chord that leads us back into E-flat minor for the song's chorus. But even here, the tonic is rendered fragile on its reemergence, as James Jamerson stubbornly remains on a B-flat bass note for the first two bars of the chorus, placing the reemergent E-flat tonic chord initially in second inversion, before correcting itself to root position, if you will, in the third measure. To top this off, while Levi Stubbs' lead vocal squarely emphasizes the pitches F to E-flat, scale degrees 2 to 1, on successive downbeats in the first two bars of the chorus, the pianist, presumably Earl Van Dyke, is most definitely playing an E-flat major triad in his right hand above Jamerson's B-flat bass note in the second bar. It goes without saying that we should not expect pop and rock musicians always to follow the rules of classical harmonic syntax. Let's listen now to this remarkable chain of tonal events. Offering his own interpretation of the fragile tonal design of Reach Out and how this might contribute to the song's overall message, Everett claims that, quote, "The confusion, illusion, fear, cold, and drifting that trouble the singer's love object in the verse turn to raw paranoia in the chorus, and the withholding of harmonic support and clarity are the chief expressive factors." While Everett's magisterial survey in the foundations of rock is limited to songs composed and recorded during rock's formative period, that is, through 1969, there are plenty of songs with similarly fragile tonal designs to be found among pop and rock songs composed in later decades. Elton John's top 5 pop hit, Someone Saved My Life Tonight, from his 1975 concept album, Captain Fantastic and the Brown Dirt Cowboy, is another profound example of a song with a fragile tonic. With lyrics written by Elton's lifelong songwriting partner, Bernie Taupin, He's the brown dirt cowboy to Elton's Captain Fantastic. Each song on the album provides an autobiographical glimpse into their struggles as young songwriters trying to make it on the London scene in the late 1960s. Someone Saved My Life Tonight is based on a true story from 1969, when Elton reportedly was contemplating suicide until his friend and bandmate Long John Baldry, he's the sugar bear of the song's chorus, saved his life by convincing him not to risk ruining his burgeoning musical career by marrying his girlfriend and getting trapped in an unhappy relationship. Example 3A shows the song's signature introductory piano riff, which reappears at crucial junctures throughout the song and also serves as the repeating loop for the song's fadeaway coda. I'm going to play just the opening riff. While Someone Saved My Life Tonight is unmistakably in A-flat major and the sense of A-flat as tonic becomes clearer as the melody unfolds, the initial tonic chord of the piano riff is in second inversion and sounds particularly unstable and fragile, especially as it alternates back and forth with a root position D-flat major chord. Complicating the issue of discerning the tonal center of the piano riff even further is the bar-to-bar alternation between G natural and G flat as part of the octave-doubled ascending and descending scalar flourishes in the left hand. It might be tempting to say that the tonal center here is trying to shift to the subdominant D flat, but I prefer to think of this not as a shift of key center, but as an instance of what David Temperley calls scalar shift. In this case, one shift in the flatwards direction, replacing natural 7 with flat 7, or in other words, a back and forth alternation between Ionian and Mixolydian modes of the same key. Example 3b provides a harmonic reduction of the verse and chorus. The verse begins on the same fragile second inversion A-flat tonic chord, which again does not behave as we would expect a 6-4 chord to do in classical tonality, resolving to a root position 4 chord that quickly moves via a passing G-flat chord towards an odd-sounding cadence on its own fragile second inversion, a D-flat major triad over an A-flat bass. The next phrase begins with oscillating G-flat to A-flat chords that again sound to me like a temporary scalar shift to the Mixolydian mode, hence flat 7 to 1. The root position A-flat chords that occur at this point during the verse progression are the only instances of root position tonic chords in the whole song. Yet they hardly sound like stable points of arrival. In fact, after one repetition of the oscillating flat 7 to 1 chords in half notes, the verse progression continues with D-flat major, or major 4, and the borrowed D-flat minor, minor 4, for one bar each, followed by a B-flat dominant 7th chord that does not resolve immediately as a 5-7 of 5, but instead swerves back to the 4 chord. The bass then creeps chromatically upwards towards scale degree 5, with the verse culminating on a big half cadence decorated with a cadential 6-4 that this time does resolve as we would expect it to. Let's listen now to the introduction through the first verse.
Muggy nights, the curtains drawn in the little room downstairs. Prima donna, Lord, you really should have been there, sitting like a princess perched in her electric chair. And just one more beer, and I don't hear you anymore. We've all thank you.
following this half cadence, the ensuing chorus once again defies the expectations of classical tonality by beginning not on the tonic, but on the root position 4 chord, with the title lyric, "Someone Saved My Life Tonight," set to the same 4 to passing 1/6 to 2 progression that we heard in the chorus of "She's Gone," not to mention the refrain from another famous song with suicidal tendencies, Brian Wilson's masterpiece, "God Only Knows," from the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds. The harmonic design of the chorus is even more unstable than the verse, with the bass ultimately again creeping upwards chromatically towards scale degree 5, at first overshooting it to scale degree 6, before doubling back to scale degree 4 and climbing again chromatically to 5 as Elton sings the melodic climax of the chorus, "Fly Away, High Away," over another painfully fragile second inversion tonic. Yet as soon as this climactic moment is reached, the second inversion A-flat chord yields again to the 4 chord, D-flat major, this time slyly by way of a deceptive resolution of 5-7 of 6, musically portraying the idea of a butterfly flying away. The 3-bar tag that closes the chorus overshoots A-flat and comes to rest momentarily on the flat 7 chord, G-flat major, which functions in context like a retransitional dominant, with flat 7 substituting for 5, as it often does in modal rock harmony, leading back to the second inversion A-flat chord of the opening piano riff. Let's listen now to the song's chorus. The fragile tonal design of "Someone Saved My Life Tonight," in which there seems to be a deliberate avoidance of tonic chords in root position for the majority of the song, mirrors perfectly the fragile emotional state of the song's protagonist, which in this case we can assume to be Elton John himself. I do not profess to have undertaken an exhaustive corpus study of post-1950s pop and rock songs, such as De Klerk and Temperley have done, and am therefore relying on the large database of pop and rock songs that I carry around in my head. But I think it is a pretty safe bet to say that most, if not all, songs with fragile tonics that similarly favor second inversion chords were composed at the piano and not the guitar, since true chord inversions are awkward to play on the guitar, and hence guitar-driven pop and rock songs tend to favor root position chords almost exclusively. In "She's Gone," we saw that the tonic chord was absent during the verses and saved for the song's chorus. I'd like to look briefly now at another example of a song with an emergent tonic, Prince's 1982 hit "Little Red Corvette," example 4. In her excellent 2010 Music Theory Spectrum article, Nicole Biamonte provides a useful catalog of the most common triadic, modal, and pentatonic patterns used in rock. In an earlier version of her paper presented at the 2008 Society for Music Theory meeting in Nashville, Biamonte cited the verse progression of "Little Red Corvette," which cycles several times through the chords G-flat major to A-flat major to B-flat minor to G-flat major 7th, as an example of Lydian harmony. While I suppose it is possible to interpret this progression on the local level as a Lydian 1 to 2 to 3 to 1-7, I cannot help but hear this as a series of deceptive moves. That is, a repeating 4 to 5 to 6 to 4-7 in D-flat major, similar to "She's Gone," The tonic chord seems to be deliberately saved by Prince for its climactic arrival in the chorus, where it is made to serve as a metaphor for the release of sexual tension that had been building up in the verse. As I've shown in the notated example, the melodic design of the verse composes out a linear progression of scale degrees 6 to 7 to 1, the same scale degrees of which are moved through twice as fast at the onset of the chorus as the tonic chord emerges. In certain extreme cases, however, the promised tonic chord never actually materializes. Before we consider some examples of songs in which the tonic is truly absent, let's take a moment to ponder more closely this phenomenon of oscillating two-chord vamps. Example 5 shows 4 such vamps that are commonly found in pop and rock songs, with the Roman numerals below indicating their possible harmonic functional interpretations. For ease of comparison, all 4 are transposed to begin with a chord on G. The first vamp alternates a major chord with a minor chord whose root lies a whole step above. Depending on such variable factors as durational accent, the presence or absence of a bass pedal tone, which pitches are emphasized in the vocal melody and/or riffs sounding above these chords, and which of the two chords is sounded first, it is possible in the context of an actual song for the ear to latch on to one or the other of these two chords as the tonic. In other words, as either a repeating 1-2 in major, as in, for example, Fleetwood Mac's Albatross, or a flat 7-1 in minor, as in, for example, Frankie Goes to Hollywood's Relax. Similarly, the second vamp may be interpreted either as a repeating 1-6 in major, as in the Beatles' From Me to You, or a repeating flat 3-1 in minor, as in the Police's Invisible Sun. The third vamp consists of a minor chord alternating with a major chord whose root lies a fifth below. While this vamp can sometimes function as a repeating 2-5 in major, searching for its tonic, as we saw in Reach Out, in modal rock songs, the first chord will more often than not assume the status of the tonic itself, resulting in a Dorian 1-4, as in the Zombies' She's Not There, for example, not to mention several of the songs on Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon, and countless songs by Santana. So much so, in fact, that Frank Zappa and his band in the late 1970s jokingly nicknamed G minor to C major as the Carlos Santana secret chord progression. This brings us to the fourth vamp, the most problematic of all, which consists of 2 alternating major chords whose roots lie a whole step apart and therefore might be interpreted, I say might be interpreted in context, as a Lydian 1-2. As Everett notes in The Foundations of Rock, quote, "The Lydian scale is marked by the most dissonant of intervals, the augmented fourth, involving the tonic scale degree and the distance from 1 to sharp 4. He then goes on to cite several examples of 1960s pop and rock songs that feature an oscillating 1-2 vamp, what he calls a Lydian fingerprint, such as the opening of the verse of the Turtles' 1967 hit, You Know What I Mean. In this particular song, however, the 1-2 oscillating vamp is quickly relieved, corrected, if you will, after only 2 iterations by the ensuing 4 chord, which replaces the raised 4th scale degree with a plain 4. Much more problematic from the standpoint of discerning a tonal center are those cases where an oscillating vamp of 2 whole step related major chords serve as the harmonic foundation for an entire section, or even, in extreme cases, an entire song. Let's consider two such examples. Example 6A shows a transcription of the opening of Jane's Addiction's 1988 alternative rock classic, Jane Says, a track built entirely on a repeating two-chord riff of G major to A major. Above Dave Navarro's incessant guitar riff, Perry Farrell's vocal melody consistently and persistently outlines the tonic triad of D major and seems to be at odds with the oscillating chords below. Indeed, this is an excellent example of what David Temperley and most recently Drew Nobile, following Alan Moore, have termed the melodic harmonic divorce in rock. To my ears, at least, this causes the whole song to sound like an ever-repeating 4-5 that is searching for its tonic but never resolves. Another of my favorite examples of a song that promises a tonic which never fully materializes is The Spinners' 1972 number one soul hit, I'll Be Around, example 6B. A simple verse-chorus form built entirely upon a circular groove involving alternating E major seventh and F sharp major added sixth chords. Here's the opening of the song. Again, one might be tempted to hear this progression as some sort of Lydian 1-2. But everything else in the track, from Bobby Smith's vocal melody, which persistently outlines a G-sharp minor triad and repeatedly comes to rest locally on the pitch G-sharp, to the signature string horn riff during the instrumental break, which marches down what is clearly a G-sharp Aeolian scale, with D-sharp scale degree 5 as its head note, points toward hearing this progression against the backdrop of G-sharp minor, hence an Aeolian flat 6 to flat 7 with absent 1. This ever-repeating flat 6 to flat 7, which always drops back to resolve on the flat six chord and avoid cadencing on the promised tonic, is an example of what I have dubbed the Sisyphus effect. That is, a sequence of chords with their bass notes ever moving stepwise up a hill, only to fall back down to the bottom either just before, as in I'll Be Around, or as soon as the goal tonic is reached. Example 7 shows the repeated chord progression that underscores the verses and choruses of the Human League's 1986 hit Human, a song composed by producers Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. Rather than play the original track, I'll demonstrate this song and its Sisyphus effect at the keyboard. The song begins with a catchy two-bar drum machine loop, which I won't try to demonstrate vocally, over an extended pedal drone on D flat that repeats 4 times, creating an 8-bar introduction. The extended pedal might lead us to expect that D flat is the tonic, and yet the progression that emerges confirms that A flat is actually the tonic. With scale degree 5 held as a common tone in the upmost voice, The bass marches up the hill from scale degree 4 to 1, but as soon as the tonic is reached, slips back down to the 4 chord. So you've got this pedal drone beginning the song, and then the progression emerges. It just keeps repeating. Ultimately, the song will fade out on the same pedal D flat as it had began. But I prefer to think of this song as being in a fragile A flat major, mirroring the fragile emotional condition of the cheating couple who keep reminding us in the chorus, "I'm only human, of flesh and blood I'm made." It seems only appropriate that every time the fidelity of the tonic chord is reached, the progression falls back down the hill and the cycle repeats again. All of the songs we've examined so far exploit two stylistic features that are central to the tonal design of many, if not most, pop and rock songs. One, the use of short, goalless, circular progressions comprised of 2, 3, or 4 chords, what Philip Tagg, in his excellent book Everyday Tonality, prefers to call shuttles in the case of back and forth motion between just 2 chords, and loops in the case of circular progressions of 3 chords or more. And 2, the use of a fade out to end the song, or rather cause the song to evaporate without providing full closure, most often set over a repeating chord shuttle or loop. It is these two features more than any other that set the tonal design of pop and rock songs apart from their art music counterparts, and I would argue almost invite us to hear songs or sections of songs as fragmentary tonal structures with absent tonics. But for me, what's perhaps even more important in my perception of a particular song as having an absent tonic is the way in which I situate this track within the vast universe of other pop and rock tracks that I know, musical worlding, as John Kovach once called this practice, and compare it to other songs that make similar harmonic moves. Since I originally presented my idea of absent tonics in pop and rock songs in 2009, music theorist Brett Clement, in a 2013 article, has offered a persuasive counterargument in favor of interpreting shuttles of 2 chords whose roots lie a whole step apart as exemplars of Lydian harmony in rock. I'm afraid that for most of the examples Clement discusses in his article, I simply cannot hear them as Lydian. But before we move on, I'd like to play devil's advocate by looking at 2 examples of songs that I think do have potentially viable Lydian openings. The first is the opening piano guitar riff that serves as the introduction to Fleetwood Mac's 1979 hit Sarah, example 8A, an example that Clement cites in his article. We'll listen now to the beginning of the song, where we'll hear this introductory loop first sounding by itself and then as the underlying groove for Stevie Nicks' vocal melody.
Said you give me life, but you never told me about the fire.
Notice that when the drums enter and the main groove of the song sets in, B natural is replaced by B flat, and the chords shift to the familiar, what's known as the doo-wop chord pattern of 1 to 6 to 4 to 5. Stevie Nicks' opening vocal melody hovers around the pitch C, and yet the omnipresent pedal tone F in the piano guitar riff, above which the chords move from F major to G major to A minor to G major and back to F major in an ever-repeating loop, I think is strong enough for the ear to latch onto F as the tonal center, causing the opening section of the song to sound as though suspended in a kind of Lydian zone. When the B naturals are replaced by B flats at the onset of the main groove, the tonal center remains on F, but the mode shifts from Lydian to Ionian, not unlike the type of modal fluctuation we often encounter, say, in Debussy's music. I'm thinking in particular of the opening to the piano prelude, Départ sur la neige, in which D remains omnipresent as a tonic pedal, as the mode fluctuates from D Aeolian to D Dorian when the B flats yield to B naturals. Example 8b provides a formal synopsis of R.E.M.'s early 1990s ode to 1970s kitsch, Man on the Moon, showing the chord progressions used in the verse, pre-chorus, and chorus. At the song's opening, we hear a guitar and bass groove whose chords move from C major to D major, one bar each, and then back to settle on C major for two bars. Michael Stipe's vocal melody enters above this repeating groove, marching down the scale from G to C. Along with this strong melodic descent into C, the fact that this four-bar rotation settles on C for its last two bars makes its harmonic rhythm sound fundamentally quite different from a shuttle that alternates between two whole step-related major triads every bar. In fact, if the entire song were built on this four-bar loop, I think it would be entirely possible for the ear to latch onto C as the tonal center, with the D major triads serving as neighbor chords, and the F sharps simply as part of the scale, rather than as functioning as leading tones, hence hovering again in a kind of Lydian zone. As we move into the pre-chorus, however, the underlying Lydian harmony is replaced by a shuttle of alternating A minor and G major chords, and the vocal melody begins a quick series of descents into G, shifting our focus towards G as the tonal center. The pre-chorus culminates on a D chord that this time sounds unmistakably like a big transitional dominant leading into the G major tonic chord at the onset of the chorus. Man on the Moon, then, is another example of a song with an emergent tonic, but the difference here is that the promised tonic is perhaps not quite so apparent from the song's opening. You decide for yourself as we listen to the first pass through the introduction, verse, pre-chorus, and into the chorus. Now let's consider two songs composed entirely around a series of two-chord shuttles, both by the 1980s UK synth-pop group The Psychedelic Furs. Even though The Ghost in You was released about 2 years after Love My Way, in my mind, I will always associate these songs closely with one another as part of the soundtrack to my senior year of high school and first year of college. My nostalgia notwithstanding, the two songs are also very similar, both in terms of their formal structure and texture. Let's look first at The Ghost in You, example 9A. The verse is built upon a shuttle of B-flat to E-flat chords, alternating every other bar. Notice the stark open fifths, quite typical of the minimalist harmonic language of 1980s synth pop, above which sounds a signature synthesizer riff whose opening motive is pervasive throughout the various sections of the song. Compare, for example, the opening notes of the synth riff to the Angels Fall Like Rain melody at the pre-chorus. The pre-chorus is built on another shuttle, E flat major to D minor, while the chorus is built upon yet another shuttle, this time involving F and E flat chords. I've deliberately not supplied any Roman numerals to analyze the harmonic function of these various chords, but such an exercise would be quite straightforward in this case. I'm sure most would agree that B flat is established as the tonic in the verse, hence an oscillating 1-4, and within this tonal context, we can interpret the pre-chorus as an oscillating 4-3, and the chorus in turn as an oscillating 5-4. In sum, the tonic chord is made clear in the verse, but is absent entirely from the pre-chorus and chorus, the opposite of an emergent tonic. Let's listen now to one pass through the verse, pre-chorus, and chorus of The Ghost in You.
Runs a light and all the papers light tonight, but falling over you is the news of the day. Angels fall like rain, and love, 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 love is all of heaven.
Let's turn now to the earlier Furs track, Love My Way. It should be obvious from looking at the transcription that this track is stylistically very similar to The Ghost in You, in that, again, we have an example of an entire song built on two repeating two-chord shuttles, the chords of which alternate every other bar. The texture of Love My Way is even more starkly minimalist than The Ghost in You, with its signature four-bar xylophone riff sounding incessantly throughout both the verses and choruses. Making a Roman numeral analysis of its harmonic design is problematic, however, since unlike The Ghost in You, neither of the two chords in the repeating C to B shuttle that undergirds the introduction and verses sounds like the tonic. I should note that the chords are initially thirdless, but a major third is implied strongly in both chords and confirmed later in the song by the synth riff in parallel thirds that's layered into the texture, as shown in parentheses. The xylophone melody outlines an E minor triad and strongly projects E minor as the tonic, making the underlying harmonies of the verse sound like a repeating 6-5. Yet the sense of E minor as tonic is thwarted at the chorus, as the repeating C to B progression is replaced by C to D, hence negating the D-sharp leading tone. And, as we heard earlier in Man on the Moon, the vocal melody strongly projects G major with its clear descent from scale degree 4 down to 1. Like Jane says, the effect of the chorus is that of an ever-repeating 4-5 that never resolves.
No.
Love My Way is structurally similar then to Reach Out, of which we recall that the verses and choruses are cast in competing relative minor and major keys. But unlike Reach Out, in Love My Way, the tonic chord of neither key ever actually materializes. To show that my head is not always stuck in the 1980s, I'd like to look briefly now at three songs released during the last few years, all of which made their way to number one on Billboard's Hot 100 and also peaked at number one on the UK singles chart. We've been concentrating so far on songs built on shorter loops of one or two bars. But these huge recent pop hits all feature a four-bar loop that serves as the primary groove for the majority, and in the case of Get Lucky, the entirety of the song. Example 10A shows the four-bar string loop that undergirds most of Coldplay's 2008 Grammy-winning song, Viva La Vida. The introduction sets up a rotation through four chords, D-flat major, E-flat dominant seventh with suspended fourth, A-flat major, and F minor, above which Chris Martin's vocal enters with a melody that clearly traces a path from scale degree 3 down to 1. Even though the loop does not begin with the 1 chord, there's no question that A-flat serves as the tonic. What we have here is a rotation of the classic 1 to 6 to 4 to 5 doo-wop pattern, flipped to become 4 to 5 to 1 to 6. Indeed, four chord loops featuring the 1, 6, 4, and 5 chords in some order are ubiquitous in pop and rock, including the now infamous pattern of 1 to 5 to 6 to 4, which the Australian comedy group Axis of Awesome immortalized in their clever 2009 song called Four Chords, with a hilarious accompanying YouTube video, demonstrating how this loop has been used in dozens, if not hundreds, of pop and rock songs in recent decades. You'll notice that I'm deliberately avoiding here the rather sexist nickname given to the flipped version of this chord progression, 6 to 4 to 1 to 5, by Boston Globe columnist Mark Hirsch, which became the subject of quite a heated discussion on the SMT list a couple of years ago. But that's enough of that. Example 10B shows the four-bar string loop that undergirds the chorus to Carly Rae Jepsen's, or is it Jepsen? Carly Rae Jepsen. Massive 2012 hit, Call Me Maybe. Sorry, Carly, if I mispronounced your name. The chorus melody persistently outlines the tonic triad G major, but the groove below essentially shuttles back and forth between C and D major chords. The G major and E minor chords, shown in parentheses, are merely touched upon as pickup chords to the main harmonies due to their metric de-emphasis on the last eighth note of their respective measures. So while on a local level we have 4 to 1 to 5 to 6, the overall effect of the loop is that of an ever-repeating 4 to 5, like we encountered in Jane Says. Okay, I can't resist. It's like, hey, I just met you, and this is crazy, but here's my number, but call me maybe. Okay, enough. In his 2015 Music Theory Spectrum article, Drew Nobile discusses both Jane Says and the chorus of Call Me Maybe as examples of what he calls a rotation divorce, where the melody remains essentially independent from the rotating chords in the groove below. In the oral version of his paper presented at SMT in 2013, Nobile demonstrated this in the case of Call Me Maybe by substituting various other four-chord loops in performances of the chorus melody, all of which sounded viable and correct. Now, example 10C shows the four-bar loop that sounds for the entirety of Daft Punk's 2013 Grammy-winning song, Get Lucky, the song that duked it out with Robin Thicke's Blurred Lines 3 summers ago for the title of 2013's biggest hit. For purposes of this notated example, I've simplified the groove to show just the right-hand piano chords and the essential bass rhythm. A four-chord pattern of B minor 7th to D major to F sharp minor 7th to E major. Although I should clarify that on the track itself, bassist Nathan East constantly improvises around this basic pattern with octave leaps and fills and ever varies the bass pattern with each repetition. Identifying the tonic in Get Lucky is perhaps not so simple. I actually posed this challenge to a group of theory and musicology graduate students at CUNY, asking them, if you had to assign functional Roman numerals to this four-chord pattern, what would you do? So I'm going to ask you the same question now as we listen to the first pass through the introduction, verse, pre-chorus, and chorus. The melody of the verse is composed of a series of two-bar fragments that ever gravitate towards F sharp. So perhaps F sharp minor as tonic. Let's vote. How many of you feel that? We have no takers. One of my graduate students at CUNY insists that this song is in F sharp minor, but there you go. None of you do. Okay, the pre-chorus melody follows the bass in parallel tenths and therefore seems wedded to the underlying chord loop rather than being divorced from it. Hence, the first chord of the loop, B minor, as tonic. How many of you feel that? You can't see on camera, but that's about, statistically, about maybe a little more than half the room. So third, the melody of the chorus is composed of a series of one-bar fragments that in the fourth bar seems to arrive on A. This fourth bar in the melody is then repeated over and over again in the manner of a refrain. If we were to sing the melody of the chorus in isolation and assign solfege syllables to it, then our instinct most likely would be to interpret the melody in A major, ending as it does with a clear 3-2-1 descent. Following this logic, we would read the four-chord loop as 2-7 to 4 to 6-7 to 5 with an absent tonic. So how many of you think that's the right reading? Okay. Somebody switched their vote. Okay. Swing. Okay. In the end, much as I'd love to posit Get Lucky as another perfect example of a song with an absent tonic, for me, the Dorian loop, 1-3-5-4, hence an expansion of the Dorian shuttle, 1-4, trumps all other possible hearings. And I'll explain why now. For one thing, I have to squint my ears very hard to hear A as the tonic in the chorus melody as it unfolds over the repeating chord loop, especially considering the weak metric position of A on the final eighth note of the bar, which for me undermines its sense of arrival and instead seems to wrap back around as a neighbor tone to B as the one bar hook repeats at the end of the chorus. But it's mainly here for me a question of style. In this song, Daft Punk collaborated with the legendary Nile Rodgers, the mastermind behind the late 1970s disco group Chic. And there is no question that the groove and harmonic language of Get Lucky is a throwback or homage to this earlier style. Every time I hear this song, which needless to say has been quite a lot since 2013, I cannot help then but situate it amongst the other late 1970s funk and disco tracks that I know and have been playing live myself for years, many of which are built squarely on Dorian loops and shuttles. Here's one very famous example built entirely on an ever-repeating minor one to major four. For our final and most harmonically complex example, we'll remain around the turn of the 1980s and consider a song recorded by the late great King of Pop, Michael Jackson. Rock With You was the second of Jacko's two number one singles from his 1979 breakthrough solo album, Off the Wall, and example 11 shows a summary of its formal and harmonic content. Again, with the exception of one chord in the bridge, I've deliberately refrained from offering a Roman numeral harmonic analysis, but I invite you to do so yourself now as I talk through the various sections of the song. I'll begin by playing the opening minute or so of the track, which represents the first pass through the intro, verse, pre-chorus, and chorus. I've known this song for over 35 years, but only began looking closely at the harmonic design of Rock With You a few years ago when the former lead singer of my electric R&B cover band, The Bernadettes, who sings Michael Jackson songs brilliantly, wanted us to learn the song to add to our repertoire. Our bass player at the time had played the song years before in another cover band, and so he proceeded to try to teach the rest of us the chords. The first thing he said was that the song is in E flat, which might seem logical considering that the introduction, verse, pre-chorus, and chorus all begin with an extended E-flat minor ninth sonority. In fact, the published sheet music arrangement of Rock With You adopts a key signature of six flats, indicating E-flat minor. But as I listened closely to the harmonies and felt my way through the song's various chord progressions, I was struck by the fact that every one of the song's sections culminated with a prolonged chord on A-flat, most often a close position G-flat major triad over an A-flat bass, the classic soul dominant that we encountered earlier as the central sonority in Hall & Oates' She's Gone. A plain major triad need not promise dominant function, as I suggested by my reading the E major chord at the end of the four-chord Get Lucky loop in context as a Dorian 4 rather than 5 of an absent A major. Conversely, the sole dominant is a loaded sonority, whose harmonic function as dominant is usually very clear, and when such chords are positioned at the ends of sections, like in Rock With You, I cannot help but hear these chords with A-flat in the bass as retransitional dominants. Hence, promising resolution to a D-flat major tonic, and yet, save for the onset of the bridge, each time here, the sole dominant slips back Sisyphus-like into the E-flat minor sonority at the onset of the next section. Cutting to the chase, I would argue that the tonal design of Rock With You is best thought of as in D-flat major, but with an absent tonic. The vocal melody is the real clincher for me, as it persistently outlines D-flat major and centers on the pitches D-flat and A-flat, or scale degrees 1 and 5, for example at the pre-chorus, for which I've written out the lead vocal and bass line in full, Michael sings, to use movable do solfege syllables, do, re, mi, so, so, fa, fa, mi, re, do, re, mi, fa, so. Indeed, until the song's final truck driver's modulation, which, like the finale of She's Gone, shines a spotlight on the sole dominant in bumping the tonal center up by half step, the entire melody of Rock With You conforms to a key signature of 5 flats. And the few chromatic alterations that do occur are limited to the harmonic accompaniment. For example, the modal flat 7 major 7th chords built on C flat found in both the verses and the bridge. Let's listen now to a short excerpt from towards the end of the track, starting with the 8-bar bridge, or middle 8, which begins as many bridges do with a swerve to the submediant, and which touches on a fragile first inversion D-flat major tonic in bar 6, the only instance of the tonic chord in the whole song, through the instrumental break and truck driver's modulation into the final chorus. Once again, one of the main reasons why I can't help but hear Rock With You in D-flat major is because of my situating it alongside another hit song from around that same time period that makes some uncannily similar harmonic moves, namely Stevie Wonder's 1982 ballad, Ribbon in the Sky. Like Rock With You, Ribbon in the Sky opens with an extended E-flat minor sonority, and the verse is built around a 3-chord loop that repeats 3 times. The song's refrain, the harmonic design of which bears an obvious resemblance to the pre-chorus of Rock With You, as both are based on a bass walk-up from scale degrees 2 to 5, cadences on the sole dominant the first time around, supporting scale degree 2 in the melody and affecting a half cadence, but the second time around does indeed find the D-flat tonic chord that remains so elusive in the earlier track. So just quickly, the verse loop is this. Repeats 3 times. Then the refrain. Second time around. Finds the tonic. D flat. To sum things up then, in order to make a claim for a song as having an absent tonic, There must be enough information in the song's chord progressions and melodies for us to discern the tonic when heard against the backdrop of a default major, minor, or perhaps another modal system. The tonic chord may well initially be absent, only to emerge later in the song, as in She's Gone, Little Red Corvette, and Man in the Moon, or else never materialize, as in Jane says, I'll be around and love my way. And it is no accident, I think, that in many instances these songs tell the story of a romantic relationship gone bad, as in She's Gone, Jane Says, and I'll Be Around, in which case the absent tonic may be interpreted as a powerful musical metaphor for lost love. Of course, a fade-out would probably be the most elegant and appropriate way for me to end this talk, but without access to a volume knob, I shall simply have to stop. Thank you.
Fantastic. We've got a little bit of time for questions and comments, so open the floor.
Yes, Chris, thanks.
Thanks for this terrific paper, Mark. You're a rock musician yourself, and you've been in all kinds of rock music performance situations and talked to people whose primary or only musical language is rock performance. Is there any value, anything we can learn from what rock musicians say about what the tonics of their songs are? I mean, you know, in your last example or your next to last example, you kind of dismissed your bandmate's perception that some particular note is the tonic note. And I'm just wondering, like, how much does that generalize? How much do you feel like rock musicians aren't sort of our correct source of insight into how the syntax of their language?
Well, that's a very good question, Chris. And in the Bernadettes, for example, I'm really the only trained musician in the band and the only one who really understands and uses music notation. So, for example, rock musicians frequently make enharmonic errors. Oh, here's a B flat major scale, B flat, C, D, D sharp, F, G. They don't understand some things that we would be correcting music theory fundamental students on. This doesn't mean that they can't play. This doesn't mean that they don't have ears. They just don't have that connection between the knowledge and the understanding of music notation that we do as trained musicians who've worked with that. So this is not to say that I don't value the opinion of my bandmates. I love them all very much. But in the case of the E flat minor, or saying that Rock With You is in E flat, I actually did talk to my bandmates about this. They said, wow, you're right. It really does kind of sound like that. And they could understand why I hear it that way. So there is, of course, a lot to be learned from rock musicians who don't have the same vocabulary. The couple of articles that I quoted in my work cited from Slate by Owen Pallett, you know, is attempting to explain. I mean, this guy is a songwriter, and you know, he understands about music theory, but he's trying to couch these songs like Get Lucky and Katy Perry's Teenage Dream from the perspective of a more accessible kind of language that a mainstream audience could understand. There's certainly value to it, but I don't also think that it's wrong to also teach my bandmates a bit about music notation when I can. I guess that's probably my answer there. But I guess also, however, conversely, many of you are arguing for the absent tonic reading of Get Lucky, right? And I, as a practicing funk musician, I suppose, playing this kind of repertoire for a long, long time, cannot hear it that way. Even though perhaps a more classically trained musician would probably favor the absent tonic reading, I think. In fact, one of my own CUNY graduate students has a blog, and he actually cited me a couple of years ago, or 3 years ago, when Get Lucky came out. He immediately wrote about it on his blog, and he said, music theorist Mark Spicer would call, he actually, you know, presupposed that I would say that this is a song with an absent tonic, and I disagree with that reading because of my own familiarity with the style of late 1970s funk and soul. So it can kind of go both ways, I think.
It seems, yeah. Just to follow up really quick, it seems like I agree with you about that one, by the way. I can't hear it as being anything other than your, I think, Dorian reading of it. It seems to me that it might be that rock musicians have a wider perspective on the range of mode that might be acceptable, and what the absent tonic reading frequently relies on, even where it is pretty audible, is the sense that most songs are going to be in major or minor, and that modal reading.
That's right. The default major or minor, I kind of dangled that as a bit of a carrot. There are some examples that I could say that you could hear the oscillating two major chord shuttle as, say, a flat 3 to major 4 when read against the backdrop of a major triad doubled minor pentatonic rooted system. Now that's tricky, and it would take me a long time to explain that, but there's an example in Brett Clement's article, a song by Tears for Fears called Head Over Heels, which begins with another C to D shuttle at the beginning. And he has that as an example of a Lydian opening. I hear that as a flat 3 to major 4 that's promising the major 1 that comes at the beginning of the ton of the verse. Why do I hear it that way? Because elsewhere on the same Tears for Fears album, there's a song Shout, in which the entire verse is built on a flat 3 to 4 shuttle. And I'm situating it in context of other songs in a similar style, in this case by the same band. So oftentimes the reading must be contextual and not just sort of taken as a great autonomously as a grain of salt. But that's a more tricky case. But yes, the major minor is usually the default for these absent tonic situations.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Mark, thank you for a very stimulating paper. I live my life mostly in the world of unpopular music, yeah. So I feel barely qualified to ask this question. But I think of Donald Francis Toby's comment that if one plays any major chord long enough and loudly enough, it will begin to sound like a dominant. And he says this because he's dealing with music that is in major and minor only. And so this more permissive world of different kinds of modalities, that may be why some of these pieces permit different hearings. And I'm struck, you know, in the opening you raised the possibility, some might ask, are these pieces even tonal? But the three possibilities given us all presume that these songs are tonal. Is that a fair assumption? In other words, because you come down saying, I can only hear it this way, but you also cite your colleague who says they can only hear it that way. What are we to make of that? Or could, I don't know, people conceive of pieces that are progressively tonal or pieces where there's something like mutability?
There certainly are pop and rock songs that are progressively tonal, by which you might mean a song that begins in one key and ends in another key. That's how Walter Everett defines progressive tonality, and there are several Beatles songs, for example, that do that. One that comes immediately to mind would be Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, where the verse, pre-chorus and chorus are all in three different keys. So the song begins in one key and ends in another. But yeah, I would say that the overwhelming majority of pop and rock songs are tonal. I would have to say they are. To say that a pop and rock song is devoid of any kind, is truly atonal, I mean, surely there are probably some experimental progressive or groups and some of King Crimson's, you know, early 70s avant chamber rock, like, sounds pretty atonal, yes. But for the most part, pop and rock songs are tonal music. They just don't behave in the same syntactic ways that we expect classical tonal pieces to work. So it's in the syntax that the difference lies, I think. We're still hearing tonal centers. Our ear is still latching on to tonics, if we can call them that, right? But these loops and shuttles get us caught in these ever-rotating...
Yeah, I find myself doing something things. Like Gottfried Weber's Merdeutica, you know, for which of these plausible hearings seems possible.
That's
and
right.
I also think about, like, in film studies, there's the idea that a film invents its own world where, like, if there's some supernatural element, you need to ask yourself, okay, is this plausible within the world of this film?
Yeah.
Is this something I want to, and some of these songs I hear them as asking me, am I willing to accept a Mixolydian?
Yeah, that's right. There's always going to be other ways you can hear these things. And I just have to put myself forward as a fairly trusty tour guide who's been living in this world for a long time and offering my own readings and my own opinions. And there's always going to be someone, oh, no, Spicer, it's an absent tonic. There's always going to be someone who does that. For all of you who are budding music theorists, there's always going to be someone who's going to say that you're wrong, because that's what we do often, right? But I think that the idea of these multiple readings of these songs and inviting perhaps further analyses of these songs and further discourse about these ideas is exactly what I'm trying to do, and I think what we all should aspire to do as music theorists. So I'm just kind of, I've been living more in the world of pop and rock music than you have, than, I grew up playing both classical and pop and rock music, so I've just kind of made this my home for the past couple of decades. Yes, Alyssa.
This is a little more specific, but I'm wondering a little bit about the use of extended or non-intrusion stories.
Yes.
A couple of the examples you use, sometimes it seems like it's just arising out of the style. With particularly example 7, the Evenly example, it seems like up to a certain degree in that one, you pay attention to the extended tonight of the Black Majors. It could have a nice voice reading or implication. Mm-hmm. Maybe better served for Drew, but also in terms of just reading that as scan 3-5 in your reading of it in A-flat. Do you notice any other examples of that maybe they...
It is scale degree 5 in A-flat.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I put... Well, in that case, you often have what you might call an inverted pedal. You know, there's a lot of songs which have that pedal point, pop and rock songs that have their pedal on top rather than in the bass. Another example of that would be something like this. The first song from Radiohead's Kid A, where there's constantly a C on top in every chord. So, right, and you get that sort of whatever you call it, that kind of Spanish kind of modality kind of sounding. All major triads, but with a held C on top. Here, I put the numbers in between just to invite a kind of, you know, outer voice counterpoint there, a kind of wedge 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, then it falls back down the hill again to the 9. So, yes, I mean, you can find some voice leading models there, I think.
Yeah, I was just thinking that, just trying to see if it was as consequential as it being in the rock and blues as it happened with that one.
I mean, this particular song, Human, sounds very much unlike the earlier songs that you might know by this band. And that's because they sort of revived their career after about a couple of year absence by bringing on Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, who were two African-American producers who had just got off working with Janet Jackson on their Control album. So they're the ones who wrote this song, and they're used to playing these lush keyboard sonorities, you know, which you listen to like Don't You Want Me or some of the earlier Human League songs, and they sound more like the Psychedelic Furs than this. So this sounds more like soul music to me, really, harmonically, in the harmonic language. Yeah.
Well, we're coming up on 5 o'clock, so if there's one more question or comment. If not, let's thank Mark very much for being here.
Thank you.